So, we are beginning this evening's event. Welcome everyone to the first European Energy Salon of the season here in the Heinrich Böll Stiftung. We will be speaking in English during this entire event, but we will have question and answers at the end where you're also free to ask questions in German. Welcome also to our online viewers who are watching us via live stream. We hope that you can hear and see us well. The European Energy Salon, for those of you who have never joined our regular meeting, is a regular framework in which we discuss here at the Heinrich Böll Foundation about current European energy issues. And today we are talking about the energy transition and structural change in different European contexts. We know that the energy transition is technically possible and feasible, but we also know that if this transition is to be successful in Europe, we need to create a socially just narrative for it that gives new economic opportunities to the losers, to the winners of the old system that was based on fossil fuels. In a sense, tonight we want to discuss about how to make the energy transition politically possible throughout Europe. And I'm very pleased to have these distinguished panelists here who are all women. How often do you get an energy panel with all women? And to share some insights from their regional context. We have Pinar Demircan from Turkey. She's a researcher, volunteer, independent journalist, but most of all, a grassroots environmental activist with an interest in environmental justice and in environmental movements. You are here to talk about the nuclear energy sector in Turkey. Then further along, we have Dagmar Schmidt from Germany. She's the program director at the Drosos Foundation, working on the transformation process in Eastern Germany. She's also a founding member of the Lausitzer Perspektiven, an organization that is trying to shape the transition process in Lausatia in Eastern Germany. The organization works under the motto talk, 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 and you're basically being a platform of bringing different stakeholders together in the process. Then we have Miriam Rodriguez Ruiz from Spain and Semi from Greece, because she's lived in Greece for 20 years. I don't know whether you categorize as a Greek citizen, but very welcome. You're here to talk about Spain and Greece. She's a founding and board member of the Spanish Hellenic Chamber of Commerce in Athens and in Spain. Since 2016, she is the president of the energy cooperative Electra Energy in Greece, which is a cooperative, and we're looking forward to hearing about your work later. And then last but not least, we have Konstancja Żoląska from Poland. She's the only non-activist in this group. She's an economist and a sociologist by training and works as an analyst at the Institute for Structural Research in Warsaw. Her work focuses on looking at the economic impacts of structural change, mostly on the labor force and on poverty, energy poverty issues. So, without further ado, I would like to invite Pinar to share some insights from Turkey. What are the energy challenges and how does your day-to-day work fit in to fighting those challenges?
Good evening, everybody. Yes, I'm from Turkey, a country who has been on news for many years, maybe last five years. It's very energetic, actually. Yes, here I am to talk about Turkey, especially on nuclear issues. I would like to share some information. But before that, I should focus on climate change issue, because Turkey is one of the countries who signed Paris Agreement in 2015, but didn't ratify it in the parliament. So today we are still investing on coal. So coal energy is something that we have raw material, of course, but mainly in our coal thermal plants, we use imported coal. So when we consider this fact with the climate change issue, Turkey is using a source which she doesn't have, which she preferred to use imported specialty of the raw material is adapted to the coal thermal plants, you know, it's the best one maybe. So anyway, coal is imported about 30%, and then actually we have also natural gas. We have been using natural gas so long, and we are also importing natural gas. There are natural gas power plants too. So totally 40 power plants in within all these imported products, imported raw materials. So coal is something that Turkey also introduced to go on further. The investments will rise, and till today, for example, greenhouse gas emissions is about 462 million tons, and will be that much more in the till 2040. This is the aim that the government is explaining. Anyway, today government, the same government, is introducing nuclear power plants as local and national energy. How could it be? We don't have uranium. We will import this uranium to establish nuclear power plants. In 2010, Turkey agreed with Russia to establish one nuclear power plant at the coast of Mediterranean. And it was the first nuclear power plant which was totally considered as build, own, operate, which means you give the land for free, you let the country operate it and own it, like a consulate. And the same was repeated with Japan in 2013. Again, built on operate, and the reactors will be Atmea. Atmea company is, you know, established by French and Mitsubishi, French Areva and Mitsubishi, and they have problems already. But they will establish Atmea 1 reactor, which had never a trial in the world. Same for Akkuyu. Russia will Russia proposed to establish VVER 1200, and it is also never tried. It was also never tried in the world. So are we guinea pigs? We need to ask this. So this built on operate kind of agreement makes the situation very confusing. About the independency of the regulatory, you know, after Fukushima, I'm also very focused on Fukushima. I am a Japanese speaker, trilingual in that way. Trying to enlarge our relations, anti-nuclear fight with Japan and also other nations too. After Fukushima, you know, no problem. After Fukushima, independency became a very big issue in nuclear power plant operations. In Turkey, this regulatory, nuclear regulatory organ, will be directly linked to president. Actually, now it's set energy ministry or prime minister, but it will be directly linked to president. So Investing on nuclear energy will also something, you know, government in order to invest nuclear energy, try to ignore public. So the opposition against nuclear power plant, I'm from grassroots, from 1976. This is when I was born, actually, not that much grassroots, but yeah, it's old. So all country has a general mind to be against nuclear power plants. So we know that we don't have uranium. Even we had uranium, we wouldn't let this happen, because nuclear power plants is a big issue to discuss all in the world after Chernobyl, Three Mile Island, or many 50 disasters that we know, and also nuclear bombs, that they are all linked to each other. So nuclear energy is something dirty, never can be a solution for climate change, not a clean nuclear, let's say no clear. Yeah, this explains the situation. One more thing, Turkey has huge renewable energy sources, solar and wind. But by investing, starting to invest on nuclear energy, it will also push us far away from renewable energies, unfortunately, which means that there will be a huge load on our back. So we will try to, it's expensive, it's not cheap, to 12.35 cents, for example, for Akkuyu nuclear power plant project, the prices per kilowatt hour. And recently it was understood that renewable energy, like wind energy, is 4 times less than this price. So it's illogical.
Yes, you mentioned a really important point, Pina. Thank you, that renewables are now so much cheaper than new nuclear. Yeah. And somehow this message is not coming across to the populations. It's an unknown fact in a way.
We have a 1% solar panel investment only, 1% in total consumption of energy.
I wonder, Pina, because you are a leader in the activist movement against nuclear power in Turkey, whether you can share with us a little bit about your strategy. What has your strategy up to now been in fighting or informing the public about the real cost and the real dangers of nuclear power? And how much are you actually proposing a viable alternative?
Actually, fighting against nuclear also something to support renewable. I believe, because you need to bring the alternative also to tell people that another solution is possible. We are not dependent on nuclear. I mean, we don't need it. It's not the only solution. How can they can bring it in front of us? But about our fight, I can say that we have court cases. We have been fighting so long. For example, public hearing was performed by avoiding public from getting into this meeting. In Sinop, it happened. So in Akkuyu,
how was that done? A public hearing?
Yeah,
a public meeting
hearing.
Without the public?
Yes, without public, because public applied to take a place in the meeting, to tell their ideas, to share, to participate. Wanted to participate, as public hearing is should be open to all public, I guess. But even journalists were not allowed. Me too. Yeah. And Sinop people who will be directly affected, because nuclear power plant will be established in 14 kilometers away from the main city center where 50,000 people live. So they will be, of course, distance is not the issue for nuclear power plant, even for Chernobyl, 1,000 kilometer by bird fly, I can say. We are affected. In Black Sea, there's a huge contamination still today, because you know half times. So about the fight, we have court cases, but before court, for example, for EIA, you know, environmental impact assessment, public try to use this way. by being again trying to collect the views of experts and use the power of law and put it on the court. But the government is against such approach, and even in the final court case to cancel environmental impact assessment, which was given in 2015 by no reason. I mean, this environmental impact assessment shouldn't be valid, shouldn't have been valid, but it was agreed in 2015 when Putin visited Turkey.
Okay.
One more small thing. So this participation is not allowed, and court cases. Even our president before court case told that this anti-nuclear people will never be able to avoid the project. Before court case, this was said.
Thank you so much, Pina, for sharing some of the issues that you are running up against. Let us move to Germany. Germany is often internationally and in Europe regarded as an energy transition leader. And someone is laughing up front here, quite rightly so, because we're not reducing our CO2 emissions due to our large brown coal sector. Dagmar from Lausatia, Lausitz region, you are one of the leaders in trying to orchestrate what this transition away from coal is meaning for the region. I would love to hear from your day-to-day work and how your strategy is taking place, and how you see yourself as a bigger part of the bigger picture in getting Germany on track of to meet its climate goals.
I was told I should talk about challenges. Challenges and successes. Lusitia, I guess most of the people here know where Lusitia is and lignite mining in Lusitia, how important it is at the moment to create power for Germany in the transition process. And it's one of the paradoxes that we've actually increased lignite mining and coal fueling, so to speak, in the process of having exited nuclear power. And with that, obviously, our CO2 emissions have increased. And the challenges are still that we now have to exit lignite mining and burning coal. So I think that's still our main challenge. And the paradox is the challenge. We have the Energiewende, and certainly we don't debate anymore whether sun or wind or any other alternatives are viable options. I think we have learned that those are viable options. What we haven't learned so far is how we can exit lignite as one of the fuel sources. And I think in Germany it's predominantly an economic decision. It's not anymore that we would debate that we could not create enough power to survive with other alternatives. But what we don't know, and I think Lusitia is a very good example for that, is how we transition from an economic model that is linked to lignite mining. And we are challenged in coming up with the ideas in, I would say, a region that is already hard hit by economic decline after the reunification of Germany. And the loss of many, many jobs has created a lot of fear of losing the few attached jobs to lignite mining, in addition to in the past having lost already hundreds of thousands of jobs. So we are actually debating around the economic transition. And I think it's highlighting that we have, as Germans, not answered the question how we can have an Energiewende and a society changing and an economy changing accordingly. So our challenge is actually finding ways of almost finding new ways of, kind of running our economy. And that just shows how big the challenge is. I think the debate around whether we have enough power to to create for any economic system, I think that's not the challenge anymore. So what we are focusing on, as we are civil society, as we are a civil society organization, we are trying to come from a civil society perspective. So we say if we don't also address that we have to live a good life in the future as well, and that we how we can get there, living a good life without mining lignite, burning fossil fuels, that answer we don't have, not in Lusija, not in anywhere else at the moment. So we say maybe Lusija could be a model region starting to actually having a discourse about how we have a future with a good life post-fossil, if we take seriously the Energiewende and the CO2 emission reduction. So that's where we started from. What I'd say a challenge is, I started working in Lusija in 2012. And at the time I was looking at where are the civil society regional actors, if you think of a transition and the great transition and kind of living in a different way in the future, and would we be able to find enough forward thinkers who would be maybe challenging the status quo, being change makers. And at the time in 2012, that was against the backdrop of us not really having made a decision of exiting coal. And at the time, I also didn't find enough people, and especially not institutional organized people to say, okay, we could start the challenge, because the focus was still very much in the protest and the grassroots protest against lignite mining. I think if I look at 2018 and having forwarded 6 years from then, I think we've come a long way. At least we now can have a debate around how can we live in the future without lignite mining. It wasn't possible 5 years ago. And so I see that is already a success. With all the backlashes that we experience, I'm not saying that it's perfect, but I think it's already progress. And what we also see that more and more we find that that people organize themselves, and I mean also state is organizing new commissions, new structures to really start that transition process. So I think we're much further than we've been 5 years ago. So for me, it's I'm slightly optimistic at this point, much more optimistic than I was 5 years ago. So I would hope that Lusija could be a model region, how to exit lignite, because if we don't really, if we as Germans and as Germany do not successfully handle the issue of reducing our CO2 emissions and doing so in an industrial and highly diverse economy, then who else is going to do it? For me, that's the biggest question. So I think we cannot really disregard the economic question, and a just transition should be our goal. That we can do it with renewables, I think that's out of the question.
Thank you, Dagmar. Let me just follow up with one question. Very interesting to see how over 5 years you've already witnessed structural change taking place in the minds of the people, that they're now willing to actually think about a future together for the region. And my question is a little bit tying into what's happening in German politics. I mean, the government has said that they want to set up a so-called coal commission to look at how this structural change can be brought forward. And it would be fabulous to just hear from someone who works on the ground in Lusija to hear what you're thinking of what of these government plans.
Yeah, it's you see, I'm actually quite happy that it will be there will be a commission. You know, a cynic would say, what is it going to be? You know, but on the other hand, I think it is actually progress. And I think it is tied in. We also have to realize how difficult change is in daily life, in organizations, in groups, in ourselves, in society. So if we are not willing to really think structurally, and we are Germans, you know, we're not going to enter a disruptive way of change. That would be too taxing for our, you know, it's our culture not to disruptively change. And I think especially if I look at Eastern Germany and the disruptive change of reunification, if we don't take seriously what has happened then and what challenges we face in the future, living into a new way of running our economy and living together, then we're disregarding how difficult it is, and we really shouldn't make light of it. So if a commission is reaching certain groups within government and certain groups within the economy, especially if a national commission can reach into federal states level, which is for me a real advantage if we could reach on that level, because there I see the biggest problem. I think it is better to have a commission than not to have it.
The biggest problem on the federal level, can you just elaborate?
You see, if you look at the federal system in Germany and the system that we have built, and if you look at education, for example, you see the problem that we have with the federal system. And it is not a transformative system. It is not built to change. It kind of it looks into what the national level and on that level is decided, how can you then transfer it to the states to implement it. And for a transformation with regards to Lightnight, I would say that is really more of a break than a supportive system so far. And if a commission is actually addressing those issues that are coming, you know, basically working, states working with the national government, if a commission would be able to mitigate of some of the stops that we have at the moment with regards to transformation, I would welcome it. So, because from a local level, we can't really get anywhere if on a state level, we're not getting somewhere. And that's the problem, you know? We really have a system that is not made for change. And we build, you know, we say, okay, that's why we say talk, talk, talk. It's not, talk is not for nothing, but so far we had a very antagonistic approach in the region, and it was not really possible to have a debate around how we want to live in the future. And if we enter a state that we can start talking with each other, and that would be already progress.
Thank you for that. Miriam, you are here to talk a little bit more about a positive example, a positive alternative about energy cooperatives in Spain and in Greece.
Yeah, hello. Thank you, Sean. And thank you very much for the invitation, first of all, because it's a great opportunity to share our experiences in the energy sector and to be all woman. So, I'm Spanish, actually, but I have been living in Greece for 20 years now, and I'm back right now in Spain, but I have family in Greece, too. So, Greece, actually, I wanted to talk you and to begin to talk you about my experience. I went to Greece 20 years ago, and Greece was a paradise for the renewables. It was incredible. It was in the 97, 98. Everybody was, because the market, the energy market was liberalization. So everybody could produce electricity. And the best way to produce it with clean energy, it was with renewables. So there were a lot of companies interested in this market. And I have been working in the last 20 years in big companies. Big companies, actually utilities. They produce electricity, among them with natural gas, with coal, but with renewables too. After these 20 years of experience, together with some young people, because you can see here there are young people interested in these issues, we created an energy cooperative. Why an energy cooperative? Because it's the way, there are examples in Spain, and we wanted to create it in Greece. And actually, it's one of the first energy cooperatives created in Greece. It's actually ours, Electra Energy. There are other two in the islands and in the north of Greece. We are actually in the capital, in Athens. Our objective was to bring all the young people together, engineers, and not only engineers, but with socials training, communications training, in order to make a reality of the energy transition, Energiewende. So, energy transition is very important for us, and that's why we created this energy cooperative, and actually, it's 1.5 years old. It's very, very new in Greece. And there are experiences in Spain with a lot of years, and here too, in Germany, you have also cooperatives, because we belong to this federation of RESCOOP, which is a European Federation of Energy Cooperatives. And all of us, what we're interested is in creating the opportunity of this energy transition from coal, from nuclear. Fortunately, Greece, we don't have nuclear. They don't want to talk about it. It's in the mind of the Greeks. And to make this transition to the renewables. In a country like Greece that we have sun, if you have been in Greece, I'm sure that most of you, maybe for vacation, there is solar, there is sun, there is wind, but not only this, there are geothermal energy too, biomass, in the agriculture sector, there are a lot of renewable sources. So 20 years ago, it was a paradise. Until the crisis in 2009, 10, 11, it was incredible how this energy transition was not made with a little bit of head and to make it sustainable. This is the key word right now, to make this energy transition to be sustainable, to be efficient, and that everybody can go and produce their own electricity. Because I have a question here for you. How many of you, if you want to produce your own energy, or heat, or electricity? Yeah, put your hand. Only
one here?
The question
is want, right? Yeah? Or do?
Produce.
Already produces or want produce, to produce?
Produce for consuming, for self-consuming. Do you produce?
It's less in cities.
Not. I was asking because let's say Germany. Okay, they are very ahead with the renewables and so on. So I was expecting a lot of hands up. Unfortunately, there is not. Okay.
These are young people. They're planning. A long way ahead.
Okay. So the last years, actually in Greece, I will talk right now for the policy and then political. Decisions that have been made in Greece right now. There are two laws, very important now. In 2016, there is the first law is for virtual net metering. This is that's for self-consuming. You can produce and consume what you produce. Okay, but the virtual, it means that you can produce in somewhere and consume somewhere else. It's very important because if you produce energy in general. If you produce electricity from solar panels, you cannot put solar panels in your house. You can if you have a roof. Okay, go ahead. But there is a problem of space. So you can produce in somewhere, schools, in the roof of the schools, in in places where there is enough space, produce electricity with solar energy, and you can consume it in the same region, in the same city. Okay, so this is one of the law that was published in 2016 that provided the municipalities and to produce their own electricity. Now, to 2018, there is this law, actually it was voted at the end of January, for energy communities. This is a very good tool in order to produce electricity or energy with renewables. These energy communities, this law, actually what it permits is everybody to make energy communities among citizens, municipalities, and small and medium enterprises. They can get together and produce with the restriction that has to be locally. They have to be in the same region. Okay, so the members has to be at least 5 members. That they can be personal, natural or legal entities or persons, natural or legal legal persons, and they get together, make these energy communities, and what they can do. There is the law says a lot of things that you can do. There is a list of activities, but the most important is that you can produce electricity by renewables using always clean energy. Or you can even consult in order to have energy efficiency in a community. You can produce solar. You can solar energy. You can produce. You can have a wind park belonging to the community. So, I think here a lot of you will you will choose to be a. This is a question. This is a question here. Do you believe that you can be member of a community, an energy community, in order to produce your own electricity and not depend on the big companies, utilities?
Yeah. I think most of them believe that.
Okay. So now there is a law. There is a law in Greece, and there are a lot of regions interested in this in these energy communities, and they're starting to establish them. I hope in the next years I will come back here and I will tell you that this was an exercise.
That would be great, Miriam. Let me ask you, okay, there is this law to empower energy communities in and around Greece.
Yeah.
But is there, what are the big utilities thinking about? Because this is a structural change issue that also is sort of a... is a contemporary issue that we're dealing with in Germany, where you have more and more decentralized power providers fighting against the big ones. And how is this structural change happening in Greece with this law?
We are in the beginning, so the big companies, they are not realized right now that they will have a competition. But I don't want to see it as a competition. It is not. It's another way of thinking and to behave, and what we were talking. We are persons, we want to produce our own electricity, and that's why in the energy communities. I don't think the companies will, if it's a political decision right now, so the political.
This is very interesting that the communities are pushing ahead and that the utilities are waiting to see what's going to happen. Let's hope that they stay waiting.
Yeah. So we have to be very, very careful in the implementation of this law, not to have then pseudo communities, energy communities made from utilities and so on, big companies. The idea is for small, medium enterprises, local municipalities, and citizens. You and me and everybody here.
Okay, thank you. Constanza, you're here to give us a little bit of an analysis of what's going on in Poland with specific labor sector and so the role of labor in the structural change debate in Poland.
Okay. Hello. Good evening. Thank you very much for the invitation. I think I will try to tell you more about energy poverty because this is the main topic I'm involved in. But it has. I will get to labor market as well. What I would like to tell you about is that first of all, what are the facets of energy poverty in Poland? But maybe what is even more interesting is how it happened that in less than a year, this topic became a major issue in Poland. So it was completely marginalized before, and now it's broadly discussed, and it is also perceived as a challenge for public administration. I use this term in a very broad sense. I mean that a household experiences energy poverty if it has a difficulty in meeting its energy needs, so in heating, in having hot water or the electricity. And this is because either of the low income or the characteristics of the dwelling. And maybe to give you an idea of the scale of the problem, because my institute is trying to measure the scale of the energy poverty in Poland, and we are using an indicator which is called low income, high costs. And this means that a household is energy poor if it fulfills two criteria. One is that it has relatively low income, and the second one is that it has relatively high energy expenditures. But not the true ones, but the hypothetical ones. So we don't care about how much it is spending, but how much it would have to spend to satisfy really the energy needs, so to have the have warm in the house, so to say. So according to this measure, in 2016 there were about 12% of the Polish population was energy poor, which means about 4.6 million people. So quite a lot. And if we wonder what groups are affected most, so I think there are different groups, but I would like to focus just on one group, which is the biggest one, and also the one which is quite important now in the current discussion in Poland. So these are people who live in single family buildings, which means in Poland not villas in rich districts, but just the opposite. So like single family buildings, this is mostly on the countryside and in smaller towns. So this is exactly these localizations where the energy poor live, and these are at the same time the localizations where the incomes are on average lower than elsewhere. And so most of them live in quite old and uninsulated homes. And what is very, very important is that a majority of them, of the houses, are heated with coal boilers. And this is exactly the characteristic which turned out to be crucial, because last winter, so over a year ago, we had quite a big shift in a discussion on energy mix in Poland, and this was due to air pollution, which suddenly, so to say, became a major issue in Polish discussions. So smog, because the problem is really quite dramatic, but before like nobody cared, and now for the last year, this is like the topic that gains really a massive attention of media and in everyday chats, in public transport. Really, like everybody talks about smog in Poland now. And it would be, maybe it's quite a long story how it happened. I would like just to, maybe two things are worth to stress here. One is that the great role of city activists and other activists that managed to influence the debate and to show the problem to the public. And maybe the second thing is that this is not so much about climate policy or climate change. It's much more the debate now about public health and the health of our children. that is endangered because of the bad air quality in Poland. Okay, and now who is the, what does it have to do with energy poverty? So the main, the major part of these toxic emissions come from the old coal boilers in the single family buildings. Okay, and now we have, like the government had to intervene because there were these huge expectations. So on one hand, we have like regional policies that try to, that oblige people to replace these old boilers with either new ones, but like still coal boilers, but new ones, or to change to gas heating or to district heating. And, but on the other hand, we have like government, because this is in regions, in several regions, but on the other hand, we have a big like government program, clean air program, it is called. And here I come back to this energy poverty issue, because the government realized that we can't really improve the air quality in Poland unless we address the energy poverty issue. Because these are exactly the people who experience energy poor, who have these old coal boilers on one hand, they have uninsulated homes, and they do not have money to invest to change it. So for this moment, the biggest part of this clean air program is to invest in thermal retrofitting of single family houses that belong to households identified as energy poor. So now this is a very initial phase of this program. So these are like, now this year we will have some pilots, and we'll see what comes out from these first retrofitting actions. So in general, this is more or less, for now, we can say a kind of a success story from my point of view, because something happened and direction is good. Of course, there are like very many challenges, because this program, if it really would be a big government program, it would be very expensive. Because the idea is to that if you are identified as energy poor household, is that we pay like 100% of the investition in building retrofitting, which is quite a lot. And so this is the question of eligibility of the cost of the program. And now to come just to the labor market issues, we conducted an analysis in our institute that shows that like if we increase the scale of building retrofitting in Poland, of course there would be like quite a lot. There could be quite a lot of new jobs created. And what is even more important, that like most of them could be created in the regions which are underdeveloped. So that like unemployment is not a big problem now in Poland currently. But there are some regions where still the unemployment rate is quite high, and exactly there are many, like there's many space for investment in building retrofitting. So it could let us contribute to social cohesion, so to say.
Okay, thank you, Constanza. Let me just, I found really interesting that you said that energy poverty is regarded as part of the problem of the smog issue, when really the problem is coal. It's not energy poverty, if you think about it. So my question is this. When we in Europe and in Germany hear about energy issues in Poland, we immediately think about coal. And we're always told how coal is such an integral part of the Polish culture and tradition and identity. So if you are away, if you are to move away from, this is a more philosophical question. So if you are to set to move away from coal, how are you able to change the Polish identity with this? And this is also a question I would like to ask Dagmar, who's working in the Lusatia region, because this is sort of at the heart of the issue that people are identifying themselves with the coal issue. It's not, so you're dealing with a much bigger social issue than just the economics of things. So if you, Constanza, could give an answer, and maybe Dagmar as well from the German perspective, that would be great.
Okay, so I wouldn't exaggerate. So with this idea that we in Poland are so attached to coal from the for the identity, like in this way, I would say that like that very much has changed already, because in 1990 there were about 400,000 people like working in the mining sector, and now it's less than 100. So like the really big changes occurred in 1990s, and I think that many mistakes were committed at the time, so to say. So the policy to reduce the employment in the coal sector was quite for many cities with mines. So in Upper Silesia, mostly, this policy was quite destructive, and also from this point of view of the identity of the places, because the region in general, the Upper Silesia, is quite well developing. So it's not this is the region where I don't know 95% of our coal, of hard coal, is there are the mines are there located. So on one hand, the region is quite well developing. On the other hand, there are like a few towns that are quite neglected because the mines were closed there and there is no alternative. But these are like only some places in a bigger area which is doing quite well. So I would say that now we have like less than, it's about 80,000 people still working in the mining sector. But if there is no like political will to change anything. So I think that if there would be a will, the identity issues wouldn't be the like the biggest barriers, but how to say, biggest barrier, can you say? Yeah.
Barrier.
Yeah, so I think that the problem that the generation for whom the call was the part of identity is already either retired or not more like with us. So much has changed, and I think that now we don't have this positive vision of how the energy mix in Poland could change. So this is more the thing that in Germany you have like precise goals to be achieved with renewables and with Energiewende. And in Poland we don't have like this, I don't know, this social and political will to change anything, but not because of the Silesian identity, I would say so.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense. Dagmar?
Yeah. identity. I think I would agree. I think it starts with political will to change, and we had a situation where we are still double signaling, so people can believe whatever they want to. You know, it's more of a choice, a lifestyle choice. Do I want to believe in Energiewende? Do I want to believe that we're serious about CO2 emissions being reduced? Do I want to believe my state government that tells me coal will reach out to the next 20, 30 years, the bridge is going to be extended, and on and on and on. So having a choice what I want to believe in, it makes me wonder, do I have a choice to, or do I really have to change, or do I have to question my own identity? Do I have to change my way of dealing with the way that I use power or produce power or whatever? So we've been in a situation where I think leadership has been double signaling so long that people could choose whatever they want to. And we are reaching a harsh awakening. In that situation, we fall back into what we know and what we've done so far. And really change, I think we need a positive outlook. And I think people are willing to change and adopt new ways. And but they need a positive outlook, what would come with it. And at the moment, it was always communicated as the abyss. You know, it's almost like night mining goes, and then we have an abyss. And I think a lot of things that have happened around Energiewende didn't really have a positive vibe, or, you know, it was just done somewhere else. It didn't really, people regionally didn't really attach themselves to Energiewende. They kept on going with lignite. Because state government and the companies were telling them that's the way to go. So I think we have a bigger challenge as society to progress from here. And I also would like to challenge us as Germans. You know, we're so attached to work. Ask a German, where, you know, who are you? Yeah, but first they tell you what they work, you know, and what their work is. And that's a lot of identity. And if you want to change that, we would have to question ourselves how we perceive ourselves as human beings rather than working beings. And so even the loss of 1,000 jobs seemed then, we seem to be unable to deal with it.
Miriam, you wanted to interrupt?
Yeah. I would like to say something about coal, lignite, and in the regions where the thermal power stations are using this kind of fuel, we have to give them an alternative. And this alternative, that there are actually clean ones alternatives. I wanted to say, in the case of Greece, right now, I don't know, because this government that we have right now in Greece, they are working on it, and they have one of the axes for the change of the energy mix is the disinvestment in coal. So they're reducing coal, and they are saying that they will reduce in the next year, by the end of the next decade, to reduce 40% of the production of coal, energy production with coal. And now, the next days, they will issue another law. The Greeks are very, very issue, very on producing laws. And the thing is to implement them. And to in all the governments, that's the thing. There are will, political will. There are laws, but then you have to implement them and to take care about what it says, the law. Okay. So the next day is they will in the Greek government there will be a law for the disinvestment in coal, for reducing the coal in the energy mix.
Thank you, Miriam. And you brought us to a very important point, the alternatives. And I would like to ask a last question from my side, and just for you all to get your brains working and thinking about a question that you want to raise. But let me ask the last question from my side to Pina. You are fighting nuclear. At the moment, there are two nuclear plants being planned and signed and should be built by 2030, if I understood you correctly. How much are you, as a grassroots movement, trying to frame nuclear as a or trying to build an alternative through social policy? So one that looks at the job potential in other sectors, looks at the health impact, looks at the security impact. How much are you using these arguments for your daily work? Because I think that one of the problems is that we're thinking often about energy transition and energy policy too much in the technical terms, and not how much is it actually social policy. And I think with social policy, you reach a lot more allies, in a sense. So
yes, as you say, it's social policy and very much related with democracy issue. We have a democracy problem. If laws, regulations, codes are changed according to future targets, which are related to coal and nuclear, you are tight. You can do nothing with this. You can't move. Even you are anti-nuclear grassroots coal grassroots doesn't matter, but you have huge barriers in front of you. So we also meet some lies of government. You know some myths, like nuclear is safe and clean, cheap, and also provides job employment, job opportunities. But we try to tell, this is our style, we try to tell the realities to the public by showing real numbers. And if, for example, you employ people in solar business, it's 7 times more than nuclear let you do it. So same 8 times more when it's compared to natural gas or coal. Solar provides huge opportunities, and you know, it's from again the point of view of employment. High technical qualifications is required for nuclear energy to be employed there. We have some students in Russia, for example, to be starting work at Akkuyu nuclear power plant project. But anyway, it's not enough. I mean, the way of government is just to continue their own way, even on coal or nuclear energy. But we try to show alternatives. We also make some cooperatives in renewable energy sector. So there are civil society organizations heavily working on this. And local municipalities, public relation is very important to start up projects, civil projects. For example, solar roofs, or if it is under that you can highlight, or you can enlighten the surroundings by solar energy. If you prove it to some community, for example, at a village, then it makes sense. So we need some initiatives to perform, I think. We need to show public that which is working. If the government say that, oh, it's safe, and if we say, oh, no, it's not safe, this is not the way to fight. So we need to show realities, facts, to help people understand. We need to show pictures, for example, about nuclear disasters. We need to tell people, show the facts. So this is my understanding for how to fight against lies. Renewables are not in Turkish. We have a saying that you can't cover up solar with mud. Yes, it's not possible. So it will continue shining, and we will help it to shine. Yeah.
Yes, let's shine on the audience now. Are there anyone who wants to be the first one to ask a question? Yes, in the back there. Please speak in the microphone, identify who you are, and ideally ask a question.
Hi, Claire Gauthier from European University Viadrina. Thank you for the panel discussion, was really interesting. I'm more particularly interested in energy communities, so my question is for Miriam Rodriguez-Ruiz. So you said you created the cooperative in Aten 2 years ago. So why only 2 years ago? Why not before? So which challenges or obstacles did you encounter before? Thank you for your answer.
Actually, it was an obstacle. The obstacle was the crisis that we stopped all the companies, the medium, small, medium companies, but the big companies, we stop creating and developing renewable energy sources projects. So there was not an energy market for renewables anymore because of the crisis. So we have to reinvent to see how we could go further. And the big companies, they were not very interesting, not interesting, but they had also a lot of obstacles to do their projects. So that's why 2 years ago, we got together some people, entrepreneurs and so on, in order to push up this. Actually, it is an energy community, but because the energy communities are cooperatives, are civil, social cooperatives, that they are with their objective to use clean energy and to make active the citizens in the energy plans, no, of the country.
Are there any more questions? Yes, here in the front, second row.
Danke für die interessante Vortrag.
Also, do you speak English?
Nicht so gut.
Okay.
Und ich bin ein Physikstudent aus Japan. Und
thank you very much for these interesting remarks. I'm from Japan, and I am interested in the question of the final storage of nuclear waste. After the energy transformation, nothing will change, if I'm not mistaken. So I wonder, what do you think about storing nuclear waste, atomic waste in Europe? And that's a question for whom? Maybe Dagmar? Dagmar Schmidt, I'm asking her.
Your question very well. Just for the others, it was a question about nuclear waste and whether there is a solution. What the panelists think about nuclear waste in general, and the question was raised for Dagmar. Dagmar.
That's an interesting question for me. and what do I think about? Well, we've created the problem, now we have it. You know, it's basically, it's not going to go away. What do I think? Yes, we have to think about the solution. So far, I can't say what the solution is to that problem. I'm just happy with all the problems that come with it, that we at least ended that one in Germany. You know, that's... although it created other problems around coal, clearly, at least I find still that that we exit nuclear power was a good decision, nevertheless. You know, maybe it was a bit quick, and the challenge was too big because of that. But I still would say, you know, I think we are able to find a solution for that with regards to thinking forward, how we live with having exited nuclear power. So that's the challenge. It's not going to go away, the waste, obviously.
Yeah. We have another question by the gentleman with the black shirt.
Hi, Konstantin Kaminski from Humboldt University of Berlin. And I have two questions to Mrs. Pinia Dimirkan. So the first one should be easy. So concerning the coal imports you talked about, where are they from? Yeah. So which countries are importing coal to Turkey? Yeah. And another one, so I'm striving to get an update on how Turkey is integrated in regional energy markets in Central Asian and Caucasian energy markets, and what's the new regional project after Nabucco pipeline is off the table. So I know it's off the topic of your speech, but maybe you can give a hint on this issue.
Well, I can say that 74% of Turkey's energy is imported from other countries, coal, natural gas, and petrol. So coal is imported from, different countries, wide range of countries, but for natural gas, it's mainly imported from Russia, coal also from Russia, and petrol from Iraq, so it's a mixture. But we have coal too. In coal thermal plants, we also use imported coal. But, for example, in Aegean region, there are for six coal thermal plants, and previously it was a farming land. So the geography is trying to be changed in regards of coal production, coal thermal energy production, even farming and some animal farming is excluded, is trying to be weakened, unfortunately. Yeah.
The gentleman in the front here.
Yes, I have two questions. One is about the Turkish atomic issue. Don't you think it's about atomic weapon they want, and about the energy transition? Don't we think we need a price for CO2 pollution or CH4 pollution of the atmosphere, because that really drives the market?
Atomic weapon, you say? Yes. Turkey signed nuclear disarmament agreement in 1980. Theoretically, Turkey is against nuclear weapons, but you know, it's a democracy issue, and in the future, next year, we will have a presidency election, and the public, some nationalist minds are very much affected by this feeling, so it's becoming a tool to catch some people, I can say. About atomic weapon, let's look at Sinop nuclear power plant project, which is at the coast of Black Sea. Yeah, it will be, for example, there are MOX type of fuel will be used in that nuclear power plant. So in the agreement, plutonium is also mentioned, for example. But I don't want to say that Turkey will produce atomic weapons. I can't say, you know, it's Turkey signed nuclear disarmament agreement in 1980. Let's leave like that.
Dagmar, can you respond to the CO2 price question? Whether you think that's that was your question, right? Whether you think that's a good functioning mechanism? Can you speak in the microphone? Could be hypothetical.
Well, hypothetical, it could be, yeah. It depends on the price. You know, as I said earlier, I think it's an economic question that we are asking. And the price for CO2 emissions is too cheap. Basically, that's why lignite mining and fossil fuel burning is still an economically viable option, full stop. And if we don't change that mechanism, it is an environmental decision to exit. And we all know environmental decisions are hard to carry through. You know, it's kind of I think altogether we've been fairly successful if we look at the environmental developments and movements that we've had in the past 30 years. I think we've come a long way. But if we don't link it closely to economic development, I think we're running in the wrong direction. And that's kind of, if it's only an environmental issue, I think we are always weaker than when we are linking it with the economic question, whether it's viable to burn fossil fuels.
Because if we would have a good CO2 price that really covers, for example, the costs of extracting the CO2 again from the atmosphere, then we could also pay for the structural transformation we would require for the labor markets in that region.
Okay, next lady in the front.
Okay, but this is not directly referring to this question. No, okay.
Please don't.
Okay, I have another question for you, Dagmar. sorry. You were talking before about this positive outlook that you think is necessary for people that are currently employed in lignite mining, for example. And I think that's a very important point. And I was wondering what you are doing, for example, at Lausitzer Perspektiven to show people a positive outlook or to, I don't know, create alternatives and perspectives. So if you can say something to that, thank you.
If I say a positive outlook, I would say a vision of how we can transform ourselves, really, in a good way. For us, it was, we've been really trying to push for a so-called Leitbild process for a very long time. That means that we have a regional strategy process, a participatory strategy process, where we could debate and argue and vision together the way that we want to live in the future. We called it the good life in Lusitia, das gute Leben in der Lausitz, because we believe that without that idea, all the transition activities that we're going to now face, you know, they're going to come anyways. And it's a transition of the power. It's a transition of how we live together. It's a transition of mobility. It's a transition of the economy, et cetera, et cetera. We think we can kind of argue and develop much better if we have first got together to an idea of a good life. And that is really something that gives you a positive attitude towards change, and that's our hope. And we're now seeing that they've started a Zukunftswerkstatt Lausitz, which is funded by the government, and they are actually commissioned to organize a Leitbild process. And what we're doing now as Lausitzer Perspektiven, because we are a citizens organization, we're pushing for citizens' participation, because the tendency is right now that the stakeholders who are going to be involved in that process are going to come from unions or the businesses or state actors, etc., etc. But it's not really. We hope and we push for citizen participation in the Leitbild process.
Okay, there's another question here in the second row.
Hi, my name is Alex Reitzenstein. I'm working with E3G, a climate change think tank here in the Berlin office. I have a question to all panelists from EU member states. The EU is currently starting to negotiate the next EU budget, and I would be very interested what you think could be and should be the role of the EU in the future with the various funds and beyond, and what it should change to the current approach. Thank you.
So will we start with Poland on that?
Okay, so in this topic of energy transition, I think that in Poland, the Upper Silesia, which I already mentioned, the mining region, really looks forward to this just transition fund, which has to be created to support the regions in transition, so that I think that this kind of policy, of EU policy, would be very beneficial for Poland, because on one hand the region is quite well developed, on the other hand there are like these several towns that really need more investments, and these just transition funds to show the solidarity of the EU for if we want to go out to phase out coal slowly also in Poland, we need this kind of solidarity with regions, with coal regions. So I think this kind of policy would be very welcome.
So the Just Transition Fund is enough. You don't see that we need to rethink the way the EU budget is put together?
No, this is just like the specific thing that like one step forward in the right direction. We are lucky to be one of the biggest beneficiaries of the EU funds in general in Poland, which will also change after 2020. So of course, for example, for this investment in energy poverty issues now, there is money for this. There are subsidies for coal, for boilers replacement, and I think that this kind of environmental policy should be continued. And of course, the negotiations that are now taking place are important in this matter. That like improving energy efficiency in, for example, in Poland, where so much coal is consumed, would be also a very important step forward.
Okay, Miriam?
Yeah, about the European Commission, and actually there are a lot of directives, electricity directives, that we are discussing together with the European Commission. in the European level, in the RESCOOP, which is the Federation of Energy Communities, Energy Cooperatives. And we are giving our hand in that from Greece. There are people that they are reading the directives and they're going back with their proposals and so in the regulation point of view, okay? About money and funds and so this is something else that I don't have any.
I'm not against it. And I think it's the right idea. I really like the just transition idea because I think that's really adding value to the debate. I think it should be a global fund because I really don't believe that the EU is, it should really be linked to global transition. And I think it should be linked to the SDGs. I'm really missing the debate around how do we do regional transformation linking to a framework that we've also created. So I think that debate is not enough at the moment. So yeah, I can see it really has value and merit for local state actors to be able to refer to the EU. And the funds, and they find it encouraging. But I think it should be a global fund. And I really do believe that it would be good for the EU on the transformative structures, thinking about a global fund and taking responsibility as a EU, not only for EU states.
One small input from the moderator. I think what is important with all this budget talk and money flowing into these regions, that there's a lot of effort being put into applying for these funds, that is a whole bureaucratic process, and that these regions are investing more time into becoming people who are writing proposals for funds instead of thinking about what actually makes money and sense for us without these funds. And I think this is a really important point to have in mind when we talk about structural change. Yes, money is important, but money isn't everything because you can't build your future just on money flowing in from the EU or from a global fund. There's another question by the gentleman over here.
Tapmut Topf, I'm a consumer and a retired journalist. I think that in many countries we still have a monopoly of providers as well as producers of energy and also the networks, the grids. So I would like, if you have discussed the chances for small producers, communal producers of biogas, for instance, solar energy, wind energy, to produce and then to feed into the public network and getting paid for it too. Are there any regulations, any progress, or still a domination of the big companies or even the governments in your countries?
I would suggest, because you didn't identify one of the speakers, that I decide who will go. And I think this is a question to Miriam.
Are you asking for Germany or for Europe in general? Because actually in Greece, you can do that. I mean, they are producers. It's the market is liberalized right now, and they're... it took a lot of time. The market liberalized. The law was in 2001. And from the 10 years ago, started to have producers of gas and natural gas and so on. So it took time, but the market is open to everybody to produce. And to distribute in Greece right now, not. In Spain, yes. In Spain, you can distribute or the transmission lines. They belong to Red Eléctrica, but you can be a producer and distributor. It's liberalized too. But actually, now it came to my mind because. We are part of a wind project in Spain, the Greek cooperative, because we want to learn to know how to do it. So we bought a participation of a wind turbine, 2 megawatts wind turbine, Enercom in German, okay, that it was installed in Spain, in Tarragona. And this wind turbine is a popular wind turbine because it belongs to 450 families and companies and so on. It's the first one in Greece. Here you have a lot in Germany and in Europe. In Greece we don't have right now this. But in Spain it was the first one, and the problem they had at the end, after many years of paperwork and all that, it was the utility company to connect the only one wind turbine, because of the it is open the market, but still the monopoly is taking advantage of all this, and it's difficult to connect only one for the citizen. Okay, so there are obstacles.
Okay, I think we have one last question by the lady over here.
Hi, good evening. My name is Ines Reining. I'm from Humboldt University. And I've got one question regarding the tools that we were discussing about how to make the transition in energy more sustainable or to further it. And like we talked about laws and their implementation, about information and myths and other things. And my question regards the wording. And I'm taking my idea from a book called Political Framing by Elizabeth Wehling. And she's doing a frame analysis, like she's saying words have impacts on our learning and how we understand things, and what frames come to our mind is like the basis for the understanding. And she has this critique about the labeling of the energies. She says that renewable or regenerative energy, and like we call it in Germany a lot, or dirty energies are not the good words for it. Like maybe because dirty energies always means that dirt is something you can wash off. It comes off, it's not staying. But like what we are doing with our climate is it's you can't wash it off like that. And regeneration or renewable is always implying that that something is used and then it comes back. But that's not the case with the sun and wind and the other energy. So I'm thinking about, would we need a new framing or new wording in order to do the transition and do the change?
Who's your question for?
Maybe the panel or maybe Constanze, I don't know. Thank you.
Constanze.
Yeah, so I think that for sure this is a problem, one of the problems in Poland, that we didn't find a good language to speak about energy transition. So this is why the topic is not popular. The climate policy is not an issue that is broadly discussed. So this is exactly what I meant with this air pollution, that this is the kind of framing the topic that people understand well, because it is not about like climate change, which is not so visible yet in Europe, but it's something that affects us personally. So this is, I would say, this kind of framing is succeeded in Poland. Of course, this is quite a narrow way. So we can't be so egoistic just to think about, okay, air pollution of coming from, I don't know, from this heating systems, old heating systems. This is something we can improve, but of course, to reduce the CO2, we need much more than that. And even we need it, although it will be costly and although it doesn't affect us personally. So I don't have any like other answer than this, that the framing thing and what city movements and activists managed to do in Poland is that in this particular topic they managed to find a good way to like the right discourse to tell about the problem. But for the other topics, we still need a language.
Well, thank you. I really enjoyed that this was the last question, because it highlights what we really need to do. We found in this discussion that structural change and change is really difficult to do, that we need to talk about alternatives and economic opportunities, that we need to involve public participation. It doesn't work when the public, you mentioned this, Pinar, is standing before closed doors, and all of this this feeds into developing a narrative that works for essentially everyone. And I think that's also the challenge. Thank you all for coming. The European Energy Salon meets again in June. I've been asked to maybe remind you that we have sort of questionnaires on how useful you found this evening's talk. It would be wonderful if you could fill it out, because it makes us do a better job, hopefully, next time. And I would like to thank very much tonight my colleagues Nina Locha and Silvia Weko. Nina has been very much instrumental in also putting this topic on the table, deciding on who we should invite to speak. So I'm really grateful for you for that. We will have a small reception downstairs to which you're all invited. And thank you so much to all the female panelists for coming to Berlin on a winter's day. Tomorrow, remember, is the first day of spring. Maybe we will see some sign of that tomorrow morning. Thank you so much. And please join us downstairs.